van, Delfina and the two kids were waiting in the van. And it was during this time that Joe decided, hey, me and my friends, we need this van. As you mentioned, we're going to New Orleans. We need a great vehicle.
Our car's
roomy,
a piece of shit.
Something that's not going to overheat.
That looks fun. Who didn't want to be? And when you seen vans back in the day and you're on the interstate traveling in anything but a van and you see people cruise by in a van and they're just all kicked back. You see a TV playing and shit and they're just having, they're like swiveling around. There's tables.
You're like, it's a fucking A-team. I want to be part of this.
Yes.
I want my own A-team van.
Oh, dude, you wanted to be in that van.
It's
going
true.
Down the interstate.
Yeah, a shaggin' wagon.
Oh, yeah.
I always imagined it had shag carpeting and like a mirror ball in the back.
Oh, they had like the full-blown captain's chairs that spun
like
around and
sweet
shit.
Sweet-ass van in rock and roll high school.
Bunch of extra fucking carpet and shit.
As I mentioned earlier, it could possibly have a wizard airbrushed on the side of the van.
With the little round window back
why
there?
Why do I not have this van? What
I
are
want
you
this
doing?
Fucking van.
You are failing me as a provider. I need this van, Dylan.
Okay, we're going to get that van.
Take out your man bun and buy me this van. Back to the story. Joe decides he needs this van. So what does he do? Aha. Remember, he stole those guns?
We're about to take this shit.
Okay, Gmail, I don't need your update right now. He pulls out a gun.
Oh,
and now
Gmail
Yahoo
said,
is telling
you
there's a... I know, right? So he pulls out one of the guns, climbs into the van's passenger seat. Delfina's sitting in the driver's seat. He tells his friends and Vidar to get in the van as well.
It's carjacking.
Joe yelled to Crystal and Dean to follow them while wielding this gun. So in a split second, these kids went from runaways, petty thieves.
Yeah.
Just, you know, hey, we broke in a house and stole a gun. I mean, that's pretty major, but it's going to get worse.
Right.
So they go from that to being kidnappers. Carjackers.
And, you know, a gun.
Right.
Violence, all that shit.
I should also mention that just about an hour before the teens were believed to encounter this Lily Ladd family, they were given a speeding ticket in Gate City, Virginia. I mean, if only that cop had known their next move.
Yeah.
You know, because they get a speeding ticket, an hour later they encounter this family, they're holding them at gunpoint.
That's
just kind of crazy.
That is crazy.
Joe ordered Delfina to drive them down the road a few miles out to what was more of like a rural dirt road.
I'm not going to. You got to shoot me up here at the damn gas station. I am not getting in the fucking van with my family and you're not driving me out no goddamn dirt road where it gets scary. I know you're going to shoot me in the face. I ain't going. You got to shoot me up this motherfucker right here in this parking lot.
Yeah, I mean, I'm down with that.
That's how I'm gonna do it, baby. If it happens, this might try to take our Subaru at gunpoint and tell us to drive out in the swamp and shit. They ain't gonna take you out there and have a conversation about damn your finances.
Well, I'm sure there's not a swamp around here, but
well, I'm saying that's where they're gonna shoot you in the face.
Where you're going with?
Okay,
this
I'm sorry. That's just scary.
Drive out. They find this rural road. Dean and Crystal were in the other car. You got to remember driving Joe's mom's car. When everybody kind of parks, they're forced out of the van. Joe told his friends that the family had seen them, and therefore everybody had to die.
Now, could you imagine, on a serious note, how terrified this family is at this point?
Right? I mean, one minute you're praising Jesus.
Well, her husband's out doing his thing. He probably goes up to people all the damn time. She's like, damn it, Vidar, get your little ass back up in here. We're trying to get home. You know, thinking all into two gun in your face. Being forced with you have kids in the vehicle, and you've been forced to drive to a remote location. I mean, you know those people know this is not good.
It is a frightening scenario.
I could only imagine.
One that I don't ever want to be in.
No.
Vidar was shot 6 times, Delfina 8 times, Tabitha, the 6-year-old, also shot. She actually died the next day in the hospital from her injuries. And then Peter, the 2-year-old, was shot in the eye. He did survive. I believe some of his spinal cord, like one of the bullets kind of grazed his spine. He did have some issues from that.
Oh,
but,
my God.
He was the sole survivor. The teens basically brutally, you know, murder this whole family, they think, because they don't know that the little boy is still alive. They kind of roll the bodies off almost into kind of like a bit of a ditch. Seemed like a really low ditch, though. It's not like a deep one.
Yeah.
And they load up in the van, and they end up driving over the bodies as they're leaving.
Okay.
So just disrespectful as fuck.
Yeah, so they went off the edge now, you know. You've murdered, kidnapped, murdered. The stolen car, the stolen guns, none of that shit matters anymore.
Yeah.
Now you've done the big deal, and now they're running. I'm sure they're terrified. They're scared too. I'm not making excuses for them, but they're young. They've done this crazy shit, and now they're, you know, running off in the van.
Well, the car was left at the crime scene, mired in mud.
Joe's their car?
Mom's car. I don't know why. I want to start a band called Joe's Mom's Car.
That's a great name for a punk band, but are you fucking kidding me?
Yeah. Well, I mean, they're kids. They're not geniuses. Two of this crew has very low IQs. I mean,
yeah,
let's face it. We're not dealing with, like, mastermind criminals here, right?
Yeah, so the cops show up to this horrible, terrible
Let's
scene.
Let's be honest, they're kind of a fucking bunch of dumb kids.
Their families, a dead family, show up and find a damn family, and, you know, they're like, oh, you find any clues? Like, there's a car stuck in the mud right there.
Right?
With a license tag. Yeah. Okay.
So, as you mentioned, of course, these kids are panicking. You know, what the fuck have we done? You know, we just killed a whole family. We've stolen their van. Shit just got real. They make the decision to drive on to New Orleans, but eventually they talk themselves into going to Mexico.
Okay.
So they get into Mexico. Somehow, and I'm not really sure of the details, Joe Reisner somehow gets shot in the leg while they're in Mexico. So something happens while they're there.
Wow.
Mexican authorities start to realize there's something going on with this group of kids. They spend only about 2 days in Mexico. Then at some point, they're trying to sneak across the border into Arizona, and they're caught.
Well, sounds like
they don't have any identification to get back into the States. This one guy's shot bleeding. Like, things just aren't looking so good. And on top of that, they've been driving around in this van. So once they get to the border and the plates are run on this van, this van is wanted, it's been stolen, there's a murder that happens, so of course, this is all looking bad.
So they'd made it. They made it to where every outlaw and every Western I've ever seen growing up was trying to get to.
Yep.
To fucking Mexico. They made it.
Down
they
went to Mexico.
Straight down right there and gotten some bullshit. Dude gets shot, and now they got heat down there, and they trying to come back.
While police are searching this van, searching these kids, they find a knife and a photo album of the Lily Lids in the van. Obviously, this is the right van. The plates are matching up. We find these people's personal items. And that was the other thing. There were some of the personal belongings of the Lily Lids family, you know, I guess that had been in the van, were now in possession by these kids.
Like in their stuff.
Yeah, so you gotta think, I mean, who knows, maybe one of the girls was wearing a ring.
They probably got a bag,
or
yeah.
Had, you know, the woman's purse, or I don't know, whatever. But there were a few small items that these kids had in their possession. So all of these things stacking up, these guys are definitely suspects. They get arrested and are eventually extradited back to Tennessee.
Yeah, because they're going to get you for killing a whole family.
Well, yeah.
That's your ass.
At the trial, Natasha, Joe, and Karen testify that Jason, now remember, he's the youngest, that he was the sole shooter.
Now, he's the youngest, and he has a lower IQ, is that right?
Yes, he's the younger
okay.
of the group, the youngest one. He has the lower IQ. He's also an individual that had been known in town as being troubled. He had been doing drugs since he was three. So he was already kind of a bad seed.
How the fuck you start doing drugs when you're 3 years old?
I don't know. Drinking and doing drugs at three. Coors Light must be good. I don't know.
I'm just saying, you see some, like, you're 3 years old, you see another three-year-old is like smoking a joint and fucking drinking and shit.
Well, I don't know. All the toddlers we see out at the breweries, they must be drinking. We got a lot of alcoholic children running around there.
Yeah, and rescue dogs, apparently.
Yes. It's, we're not at a real official craft brewery unless there's like a baby and a couple of black labs running around.
Yes.
So anyway, back to our stories. They're all saying basically, hey, it's Jason. He did it. But Jason's saying it wasn't me, it was Dean and Joe who shot the family. And you have to remember, Joe's the one that held this family at gunpoint.
He started
Joe's the one that had this grand idea, these people have seen us, we're going to shoot them. During this trial, the media played into the whole goth thing.
Of course.
Calling them a vampire cult.
Oh.
Headlines were sensational. I mean, the teens had admitted to self-harm, playing with Ouija boards, reading books on the occult, playing with tarot cards, burning 666 into carpets, you know, in a motel room, carving shit in their arms.
Oh, yeah.
It was just like a circus. I get, like, why the media plays this up. I mean, because it is kind of fascinating, and people are like, oh, wow, satanic ritual murder kind of thing.
How could you not print that?
Right?
But during all this time, you know, it'd been through all that, yeah. That's just sensationalism right there. And I know people's going to be talking about it.
Well, it's true. And we had talked earlier about, you know, a lot of these kids in small towns, when a crime happens, are automatically suspects, like the West Memphis Three.
There's no doubt in my mind, if I've ever been certain on anything I've rewatched or seen in true crime, is that the cops did not, when they had the chance to get the real killer of them boys, they keyed on those, you know, Jesse and his, you know, friends and Damon, or was it Damien?
Yes.
See, his fucking name's Damien, you know, and they got to be like, oh, this is all for you, Damien. Nuns falling off churches and shit.
Yeah.
Oh, it's over for him. No, but for real, the real killer, just because of this attitude you're talking about.
Well, I mean, this murder is horrific.
But these kids really fucking did it, though.
It's essentially, you know, 3/4 of a family. A little boy.
And the little boy shot in the eye.
Left orphaned and shot in the eye.
And they really did it. So fuck right. them. But they were, I mean, they were kids and stuff, but I mean, come on.
But they're definitely getting a lot more attention probably right. than they normally would have because of this whole, oh, it's a vampire cult or whatever. Well, the trial was completed in March of 1998. They were all six convicted of felony murder. Three were also charged with carjacking and kidnapping. And all of these guys and gals were sentenced to life in prison with no parole. Court testimony from the other five defendants was that Jason Bryant was the shooter. But now the judge, when he's delivering, you know, his, you know, sentencing and all that, stated that he believed that another undetermined member of the group had probably done some shooting as well, but that there just wasn't enough evidence, testimony to convict that person.
Yeah, and I wonder if they were shot with both guns, which they must have, because they were all shot a lot.
Well, I saw kind of like I wouldn't call it a documentary, but one of those sort of investigation shows, yeah. you know, that had said there was a, like, repair type of guy, like maybe worked for a utilities company or something, that had been out near the murder site on this rural road, and that he had heard two, like, you know,
separate gun
yeah,
noises.
That he thought it was like two different guns.
Right. And they had a 9 and a 22, right?
Yeah.
Yeah.
It was a 25.
A 25 pistol.
Yes.
And a 9mm pistol.
And that he thought it was like two different guns, but I didn't get much more information on if both firearms had been discharged, who would, you know, which victim had been shot with what gun.
Right.
Those details I was not able to find. But this guy believed that he had heard the murders because he said he did hear gunshots, and it was around the time that this family was estimated to be shot and killed.
Well, yeah, father shot 8, mother shot 6 times.
Yeah.
And they didn't say on the
poor
little one.
Well, actually, mom was shot 8, dad was shot 6 times.
Oh, okay. And the poor little one, they didn't say. And then the little boy once. I mean, that's a lot of shots.
Peter, the 2-year-old, he spent a lot of time in recovery. And after he was, you know, well, if you want to say that, he was at the center of a custody battle among his family members. His paternal aunt, her name was Randy Heyer, she was given custody of him. And she took him to Sweden to raise. He struggled with injuries throughout his youth, stemming from this incident.
And he lost his whole family. Yeah, I mean, there's no...
One of the reasons that she was given custody was she was able to say she could take him back to Europe, to Scandinavia, to Sweden, raise him in a more traditional style, like what her brother had grown up, you know,
right.
that whole culture. And that also she would raise this child as a Jehovah's Witness, which was what his parents wanted.
Yeah, and honestly, I don't know about the, you know, religious aspect, but